Hi, I'm Stephen Deeks. I'm a professor of medicine at the University of California in San Francisco, and I am here to give a presentation on behalf of my colleagues at UCSF to the World Medical School regarding HIV and a cure. Okay, so the first question that always comes up is why are we talking about a cure? Now, I think most people who have been following this field are aware that over the past 2 decades or so, the medical establishment, the NIH, industry, and various other groups have actually done a tremendous job in developing treatment for the management of HIV infection. We now have over 20 antiretroviral drugs, multiple different regimens. If a patient has access to these drugs and is motivated to take them, they are now able to suppress virus indefinitely, prevent AIDS, and prolong life. The problem is, I'm not going to go into this much detail, others in this series will talk about, is the so-called cascade. This is the concept that despite the fact that we have great treatment, a lot of patients, in fact, the vast majority of patients worldwide, and even in the United States, have not yet been able to access these drugs, take them, and get an optimal response. It's increasingly clear that delivering antiretroviral drugs to a global community and having these drugs taken on a day-to-day basis with near-perfect adherence is going to be a challenge. So there is growing interest in coming up with a different way to manage the infection. Specifically, can we give a short-term intervention that will prevent the virus, that will essentially eliminate the virus in an indefinite manner? Can we cure people? So it's mainly the motivation now that's sort of driving a lot of the interest. And of course, the other issue which has generated a tremendous amount of interest and excitement around the cure is the so-called Berlin patient. This is an individual who was living in Berlin, HIV infected, generally doing well on therapy, developed a cancer that required a bone marrow transplant. His clinicians, led by Dr. Hutter in Berlin, came up with a clever idea to do a bone marrow transplant in which the donor, which is naturally resistant to HIV, that is, that the donor's immune system could not be infected with your typical species of HIV. Transplant went well, generally, and the Berlin patient reconstituted an immune system that was essentially immune to the virus. Patient went off drugs right after the transplant, and now 5 years later appears to be cured, a cure that we'll come back to in a few more slides. So this case, which is now well known, basically proved the concept that a cure is possible. So we have, you know, a recognized need for a cure, and we have some scientific justification we believe a cure is possible. So the real issue now is, can we come up with a way in which we can, in a scalable manner, deliver a safe, reasonably affordable, well-tolerated intervention that will cure someone? No one is recommending that the Berlin patient bone marrow transplant be used in anything but the extreme cases in which a transplant is necessary. So this gets to the question of why it is during long-term therapy the virus persists. Why is it that treatment itself, which essentially blocks most if not all virus replication, cannot be curative? There are multiple mechanisms, all of which are being addressed in clinical trials these days, none of which here are mutually exclusive, that might account for persistent virus during therapy. First, there's a controversy around the concept as to whether or not HIV itself continues to replicate despite being on antiretroviral drugs. It's clear that this is happening. The amount of replication is not sufficient to cause virologic failure, the development of drug resistance, but it still remains theoretically possible and I think likely based on the emerging data set that at least in some patients, if not most, low-level, tissue-specific virus replication with replenishment of the reservoir is one barrier. But it's not the main barrier. I think everybody realizes that the main barrier, the real reason that we cannot cure people, is that HIV infects in a durable manner those cells, resting CD4 positive memory T cells, that are destined to persist for decades. And this ultimately is going to be the major barrier. These resting memory CD4 T cells, many of which have the capacity to replace themselves with stem cell characteristics. Once these cells become infected with HIV and revert to a state of rest, they contain a transcriptionally silent HIV DNA, and this HIV DNA within these cells persists as long as the cells exist, which is probably the life of the host, the infected person. These cells are maintained Through multiple mechanisms. They probably don't live a long time by themselves, but they're constantly being turned over and maintained in part by homeostatic proliferation. And this is controlled by a number of different interactions with the immune system that is susceptible to target and therapeutically, and is being looked at in the context of ongoing clinical research. More controversial is whether or not there is, after years of good treatment, whether or not there are other reservoirs such as macrophages. Many believe this is possible. In fact, many believe this is likely. But this is yet to be proven and the focus of ongoing research, this concept of whether there are non-T cell populations that contribute to persistence. You know, finally, it's worth mentioning that HIV infection results in a probably irreversible damage to the immune system. Parts of the immune system does not improve on treatment. And this lack of an effective HIV-specific immune response during therapy probably contributes to why the reservoir is not being cured. So a few definitions. There's a couple ways to define a cure. And this is more than simply a definition issue. It actually outlines how people approach a cure. First is the concept of a functional cure. This is essentially the cancer model in which we seek to achieve a state of long-term remission. We are a little bit hesitant to say a person is cured. And what we're essentially trying to do in this situation is to come up with a is to manipulate the host and the host environment in a way such that if the virus persists, it doesn't cause disease. This basically occurs naturally. About 1% of people who acquire HIV infection control virus on their own, the so-called elite controllers. And as I'll talk about shortly, there are probably people who go on therapy and stop therapy and control virus in the absence therapy. And, you know, the mechanism for how this is happening is unclear. It probably largely has to do with the fact that the immune system is being manipulated in a way that it can control the virus in the absence therapy. But this is essentially a functional cure. We're not trying to get rid of the virus. We're just trying to control the virus. A more desirable outcome, of course, is one in which we have a so-called sterilizing cure. This is when you basically somehow eradicate therapeutically all the virus in the body. And ideally, this would result in essentially a cure. The issue is a lot of people don't think this is possible, short of a transplant. It may not be necessary. Again, there are people who control virus fine in the absence therapy, don't need to eradicate it, and it's hard to prove. Proving a negative is quite challenging. The approach generally here in a sterilizing cure is to basically go after that latent reservoir that I was talking about in the memory stem cells, cause that virus to be turned on, and hope that the virus-producing CD4-positive T cells will die, either because of the virus or the immune system, and that that reservoir would be depleted. So, a number of questions come out of this background. First, a big issue in the field right now is the question of whether or not we can cure HIV with very early antiretroviral drugs. If you take a look at patients on long-term therapy whose virus is suppressed and ask the question, where is the virus during therapy? As I said, it's primarily in these memory T cells, specifically central memory cells, perhaps memory stem cells. These cells are among the longest-lived cells in the body, and probably after years to decades of therapy is where the virus is going to be increasingly localized. Getting rid of those cells is, of course, going to be a challenge. And the question that the field is struggling with is whether or not we can intervene early enough to prevent their seeding. Here's data from an unpublished study reported a few months ago in which they showed that if you got HIV-infected individuals, primarily men, this is a study in Thailand, if you actually got them into care and onto therapy within 1 to 2 weeks of becoming infected, it's possible that you will prevent seeding of those reservoirs destined to persist. In this study, in patients who were treated very, very early, it was hard to find virus in the longer-lived central memory cell compartment and more easy to find virus in a short-lived memory cell compartment. In theory, if this can be achieved after several years, treatment itself will be curative. This, in fact, may have happened already. The so-called Mississippi baby case, again, this is a well-known case in the field, is an example of possibly where antiretroviral therapy, if given very early, can prevent seeding. This is a theory, a hypothesis, can prevent seeding of those cells which are destined to persist indefinitely. And this baby, she was born to an HIV-infected mom, acquired HIV just before infection, probably, just before delivery. and she was placed on very aggressive combination antiretroviral therapy at about 30 hours after delivery. She stayed on those therapy for about 18 months, stopped drugs for complicated reasons, and ended up appearing to no longer have HIV. The virus did not rebound, and her HIV antibody levels were normal, or essentially negative, suggesting no residual virus. And the baby remains stable now many months after stopping her antiretroviral drugs. Why this happened, the field does not know. It's my opinion that part of this was at least to the fact that this very early antiretroviral drugs prevented seeding of these cells, which we think are the ones that are ultimately going to be a problem. All right, then the next question is whether or not we can actually create a functional cure with early antiretroviral drugs. It's impractical to start therapy during the first couple weeks and prevent seeding and the vast majority of people. And so the question is, can we get people on therapy, not maybe in the first couple weeks, but the first few months, in such a way that the host immune system remains healthy and can control the virus on its own? This question has been raised by the observations of a group in Paris who identified 14 people who started therapy during early HIV infection, not super early, you know, around 2-3 months of their infection, who went on therapy and did well on therapy for a while, several years, on average about 4 years, and who for a variety of reasons stopped their drugs. Now, these 14 people were selected by a big, large cohort and may not be necessarily representative of what typically happens, but these 14 individuals who were selected retrospectively based on the fact that they did well were noted in the absence of continued therapy to have no virus rebound. That is, and these patients now are out several years, off antiretroviral drugs, and have no evidence of a virus rebounding. Now, there's these individuals on the surface sound a bit like the elite controllers, people who naturally control their virus, but they seem different. They have none of the characteristics that we typically see with elite controllers, raising the question of whether or not early antiretroviral drugs may have protected one part of the immune system in such a way that when drugs were ultimately stopped, that part of the immune system, yet to be defined, controlled the virus indefinitely. And whether or not this is real is being actively debated within the field. Next. And again, now we're getting to where most of the energy is, because even getting people like the Visconti cohort on therapy early is not easy. The vast majority of people who have acquired HIV infection don't show up to care until their virus infection is well established. They're way into chronic disease. The question then is what to do about these patients. And here is where most of the field is focused. They're coming up with different ways to turn the virus on, to react the virus, to see if they can actually go in to these resting memory CD4 T cells that harbor HIV, turn it on in such a way that the cells themselves will die and the reservoir be cleared. This is the concept of shock and kill. Bottom line is you shock the virus out of its hiding place and then you hope that those cells die, or you manipulate the host immune response in such a way that you kill off those particularly infected cells. Is this possible? A number of groups, three groups actually, in separate clinical trials have now shown that if you take a cohort of individuals who are on stable antiretroviral drugs and you give them a drug, in these cases, HDAC inhibitors that are specifically designed to untangle those proteins and enzymes which are designed to keep transcription under control, that by doing that, by essentially blocking the host breaks on DNA transcription, you can cause the production from a lately infected genome of HIV RNA. And in one of these cells, it appeared that this HIV RNA ultimately gave rise to detectable virions. And so this is a major step forward. This actually proves that therapeutically, we can alter latency with drugs designed essentially to alter the transcription of our own host genome. Whether or not ultimately this is going to be effective in causing the vast majority, if not all, the cells to turn on virus is unknown. Whether or not this is going to be safe is also unknown. But at least the proof is there that you can actually do this in a therapeutic way. The question then becomes whether or not, if you're going to do shock and kill, the first half is the shock and the second half is the kill. And this gets to another very controversial issue in the field, is whether or not virus-producing cells during long-term therapy die. And if so, are they dying because of the virus effect on the cells, or are they dying because the host immune response is clearing those cells? We do not know. This is going to be hard to prove in vivo, but there is some ex vivo data from a variety of labs suggesting that the T-cell population, the HIV-specific T-cell population of your typical person on long-term therapy is probably not going to be sufficient to clear infected cells, raising the question that in addition to shock, we're going to have to rebuild the immune system so it's better at getting rid of HIV. Can this happen? We don't know. There have been multiple vaccine studies that have been done in the therapeutic setting to try to enhance the response to the virus. These have largely not worked. But there are a number of exciting developments over the past couple of years that make me at least optimistic that we can modify and manipulate the immune system in a way to clear the infected cells. And one high-profile study done with a vaccine that took natural CMV, modified it so it would deliver here SIV peptides, that this vaccine, which results in very powerful and potent and sustained generation of SIV-specific CD8-positive T cells, that in a monkey setting, this vaccine appeared to not necessarily prevent SIV from being transmitted, but clearing and essentially curing the animal after the establishment of the infection, proving that the CD8 T cell population does, if properly modified, have the capacity to control the virus, if not eliminate it. Whether or not this can be done therapeutic, again, is unknown. Most vaccine studies that have been done in therapy setting has failed, but there have been a number of studies, I think three in the past few years, which have given some reason for optimism, particularly if we are able to modify dendritic cells in such a way that that these dendritic cells can actually deliver powerful signals and turn on HIV-specific CD4 and CD8 T cells. This is increasingly being looked at in the cancer field and may in fact apply to the HIV-infected setting. And again, this is a robust area of research and one that's generating a fair amount of excitement. Finally, let me turn to the issue of transplantation, where we started off with the Berlin patient. First, I think the Berlin patient, Mr. Timothy Brown, who's well known and has become a very strong advocate for cure work and shown here with his doctor, Gerald Hooter, it's important to realize that this case has continued to generate novel findings. After the apparent report of a cure, the question then emerges is, well, whether or not there was any virus left in this particular patient, and this is a question our group has been struggling with. After a series of extensive investigations, we've been able to conclude at least that the patient certainly does not appear to harbor replication competent virus, that his immune system essentially does not appear to recognize HIV anymore, suggesting there's no more virus there, that his immune system has essentially been reconstituted, and that things that are often seen during long-term therapy are no longer present, including fibrosis and so forth. All this suggesting to us that a true sterilizing cure was likely achieved in this particular patient. But again, how we're going to define this, how we're going to do this in the future, remains unclear. So far, the Berlin patient's been an N of one. And the question has always been out there whether or not one can actually cure people with a more routine bone marrow transplant. Now, let me back up. In the Berlin patient case, what had happened is that there was an allogeneic hematopoietic stem cell transplant from a donor who lacked C0.5. After this transplantation occurred, the Berlin patient, had ongoing graft-versus-host disease and required an extensive amount of immune-modifying drugs. And all of this, in addition to his ablation that he got prior to the transplant, may have contributed to the cure. And indeed, a hypothesis has been out there is whether or not one can achieve a cure of HIV in the absence of a CCR5 Delta 32 homozygote donor. That is, if you take a person on long-term therapy who requires a bone marrow transplant and you give that patient conditioning to perhaps reduce the size of the reservoir and do a transplant under the cover of heart and hope that that transplant immune system rebuilds itself and takes over, will there be any more virus left? And the answer is probably. There are now two well-known cases in Boston in which this was done. These were patients who both had a lymphoma, I believe, who underwent a mild course of ablative conditioning, which did not have a dramatic effect on the size of the reservoir. The transplant was done. And over a period of a few years, as a consequence of significant graft versus host disease, the transplanted T-cell population took over, and the original T-cell population died away, and presumably with that, all the patient's virus. These two individuals have now had no detectable virus, much like the Berlin patient, had no detectable HIV antibodies. And both of them now have undergone treatment interruptions, and at least during short-term follow-up, no virus has rebounded. It's generating a fair amount of excitement in the field that a transplant can be curative. So where are we? Although the barriers are real, primarily these persistent memory T cells harboring HIV, I think there are reasons to be optimistic at this point in time. There are a number of cases, the Berlin patient, the Mississippi baby, the Visconti cohort, the Boston cases. All this has generated a fair amount of enthusiasm that a cure is at least possible. And the question then really becomes how to basically advance the various nice ideas out there into the clinical setting. And that's where we are, basically. So I'd like to include and say right now that I'm optimistic that eventually, it could take decades, there will be a safe, scalable cure that will be applicable to everybody in the world that can result in essentially durable control of the virus, if not elimination of virus, such that your typical HIV-infected person requires HIV, likely will have to go on antiretroviral drugs for a while, and then have an intervention that can result in sustained benefit once those drugs are stopped. Now, are there barriers? The major barriers, of course, are scientific that I've outlined, but there are other ones. The issue is whether or not therapy is fully suppressive, whether there's ongoing virus replication is one the field is struggling with, and I think needs to be addressed as these studies move forward. There is really no very easy way now to quantify the reservoir short of stopping antiretroviral drugs, which people don't like doing. It's possible, if not likely, that there will be no single agent that will be curative, and coming up with ways to study combination antiretroviral drugs in clinical trials will be challenging. And I think most importantly, as of now, industry support, which was absolutely critical for the development of antiretroviral drugs, is not there to the level I think most of us would like as it pertains to cure work, but it is growing. But it's clear that without a strong public-private enterprise, very much like the one that led to antiretroviral drug development in the 1980s and 1990s, without that, we're not going to get much progress. And so the hope is that pharmaceutical companies will increasingly get engaged by this question. Thank you very much.